Good morning, everyone. Good morning. So excited to be back here again. This week is flying. It's Thursday already. Cannot believe that. Let me go ahead and actually turn on my microphone. That probably helps a little bit there. It's going by so fast. This whole year, actually, it's going to be Christmas before we know it, I feel like. So today's a little different than kind of the stuff we normally talk about, but I was really excited. I got a message yesterday, I believe, and it was from somebody asking me, this is what I'll read it to you, and this is kind of what we're going to talk about today. The message said, "I'd love to hear your take on what the differences are between the New Covenant and the New Testament, and also the Everlasting Covenant." I read that and I was like, I have some stuff, you know, inside my, you know, just kind of circulating around I could pull out, but I actually wanted to sit down and really study that and be like, okay, is there a difference between the New Testament and the New Covenant? And if so, what would that be? And how would that apply to us? You know, how does that work? Is that something we need to be concerned about maybe? So I thought to start out, I mean, let's just run through the covenants really quickly. There is six of them. There's five in the Old Testament and there is one in the New Testament. Now, it depends on who you ask, of course. That is according to Scripture. According to Scripture, there's five in the Old Testament and there's one in the New Testament. If you're consulting, or if we are consulting covenant theologians, there's like 15, and there's no agreement on that. I mean, there's so many covenants. They've added so many to what we see in Scripture. So we are going to go with just what appears in the Bible, and we're going to look at those ones. And then we're going to discuss, you know, New Testament, New Covenant, Everlasting Covenant. What on earth is the Everlasting Covenant? It is mentioned in Scripture. So, I mean, what is that? But let's just start at the top here. I mean, the very first one is the covenant with Adam in the Garden of Eden. And this one in particular is a little interesting. It's never referred to as a covenant in the early parts of Genesis when this is actually established. The word covenant is never used. So right out of the chutes, when I first started studying this, I think it was about a year ago, I immediately rejected that was a covenant. Like I completely immediately rejected that because I was like, the word is not used. I don't see a blood sacrifice, which is kind of what you see throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament, of course, with the New Covenant. When covenants are established, I don't see that here. Many folks have said, well, it's because after Adam and Eve sinned, you know, God clothed them with animal skins and there's your blood sacrifice. Well, I just didn't want to accept that. I didn't think that that was concrete enough. But the more I studied it, I kind of started to see where people were getting the idea that this was, in fact, a covenant, that this was a covenant established between people and God. It really doesn't come from Genesis, like the early parts with Adam and Eve. It really comes from when this is re-spoken to Noah. But just really quickly, let's look at the covenant with Adam, or if you want to use the religious word, the Adamic covenant. Scripture does not use that word, so you can just call it the covenant with Adam if you want. I think that's probably easier. It's probably easier to remember. At any rate, this is how the covenant was spoken. "So God created man in his own image, and in the image of God he created him. Male and female he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, 'Be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over every living thing that moves on the earth.'" That is the Adamic covenant, according to kind of, you know, many, many different, you know, theologians, many different takes on this. But I'm kind of in that camp a little bit more the more that I studied this. So as we go on, I'll show you the scripture that kind of has convinced me that this is, in fact, actually a covenant. So, you know, and that kind of segues into the next one, which is the covenant with Noah, or if you want the religious word, the Noahic covenant, I believe. The Noahic, I think that's how you pronounce that, but it's just the covenant with Noah, and I think this is probably the one we're the most familiar with. So first one, number one, is with Adam. The second one is with Noah, and this is just simply the covenant never to flood the earth again. But what's so interesting about this is it's actually a little bit of a repeat of the covenant with Adam is in here too, and to me, that is kind of why I do consider what happened in the Garden of Eve to be the first covenant. Why do I keep saying that? Garden of Eden. Got Eve in my head for some reason. Garden of Eden, I do consider that to be the first covenant, simply because when God is re-speaking this in Genesis 6:18, he says, "I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall enter the ark, you, your sons, your wives, and your wives' sons with you." So in a sense, he's saying that I'm going to destroy all living things, but the covenant that I made with all living things, which is harkening back to the Garden of Eden, Noah, I'm going to establish that with you. So you know, scripture, like I said, never actually necessarily refers to the Adamic covenant as a covenant, but to me, that's probably good enough. That's good enough, especially since it's repeated later on after the ark. After the flood, God blesses Noah and he says, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth, which is an exact repetition of what he said to Adam back in the garden. So, like I said, to me, that's good enough to say that that was a covenant. That is the covenant that's being established with Noah. It's kind of being passed down to him. And in addition, of course, to the covenant of never flooding the earth again. They almost kind of meld. The first and the second covenant almost kind of meld into one a little bit there. So going on here a little bit, number three is the covenant with Abraham. And this is a multi-part covenant that is stated many, many times throughout Genesis. But really, there's a few things. One is that he's going to have a son. You know, he's going to have a son. It's going to be Isaac. It's going to be his own flesh and blood. That's part of it. The other ones kind of all relate to what Christ accomplished. The fact that Abraham's going to be a father of many nations, many peoples, that actually, you know, he's the father of the Jewish nation, right? I mean, because all the Jews all descend from Abraham. So he's their father physically. But what the New Testament teaches us is Abraham is actually our father, because Abraham is the father of anyone who has faith. All who have faith are children of Abraham, as Galatians says, as I believe doesn't Romans chapter 5, 4 and 5 speak on this as well. When Paul talks about Abraham believing in God and him crediting that faith as righteousness, anyone who believes is a child of Abraham. In fact, I'm kind of just reminded in my head of an exchange Jesus had with the Jews. And they were claiming that Abraham was their father. And because of that, somehow, you know, everything's going to pan out for them. And he says to them, and I'm going to try to quote this from memory, if Abraham were your father, you would listen to me. And you're not doing that. You don't have the faith of Abraham. You're actually not Abraham's descendants. You're children of the devil, is what he ends up calling them. Because then they appeal and they say, well, God's our father then. Okay, fine. And he says, no, God's not your father. Abraham's not your father. It's not physical descent. You're children of the devil. And until you have faith in the Son of God, that's where you remain. But by faith, we become children of Abraham, because Abraham's the man of faith. He's the forerunner of faith. And we become children of God. We're born into God's family. But up until that point, you know, whether you descend from Abraham or not is irrelevant. And that's really what Jesus was hitting home. And that's what Paul hits home throughout the epistles. So the other thing in the Abrahamic, by the way, is a religious term for this. If you want to use the religious words, you could just say covenant with Abraham, promise, Abraham's promise. You know, those are things scripture uses. Abrahamic is not a scriptural term necessarily. But at any rate, the crux of the whole thing is this. The most important thing we can take away from the covenant with Abraham is that all peoples on earth will be blessed through you, and specifically through your seed. The seed that God is talking about when he says this to Abraham is Jesus Christ. And actually, the blessing that comes to all people through Abraham is the Holy Spirit. Galatians explains all this. So Abraham never received this. Hebrews says that. He says he was living by faith when he died. He never received the things promised. He only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. So he never received this. No one received this until the cross. And after the cross, of course, by faith, the Holy Spirit began to fall upon people as he does today. So today we're seeing Abraham's promise, this blessing that was coming to all people through the seed of Abraham. We're seeing that now. We're seeing that. We've been seeing that since the cross. The Holy Spirit is being given. The blessing has come to all peoples through faith in Jesus Christ, the seed of Abraham, Christ being the seed of Abraham. So out of all the Old Testament covenants, all five of them, I think the Abrahamic is the most important. That's the most important because it's all about Jesus. Doesn't necessarily appear that way. When you read it in Genesis, you know, initially it doesn't necessarily appear that way. But when you read Galatians, which really explains this, and Romans, which really explains this, you see, oh, this is all about Jesus. He's completely the fulfillment of this. He's the fulfillment of all of them. But this one is just Jesus, 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 Jesus. You know, just over and over and over. He checks every box on in this particular one. It's all about him. Even Isaac. I mean, Isaac was actually metaphorical for you had Ishmael and you had Isaac. One was born by efforts of the flesh. One was born by means of a promise. Ishmael was by the flesh. Isaac was the result of a divine promise. And through Isaac, Abraham's offspring would be counted because they would be by a promise, not by works, which is the big point that they'd be by faith, not by works. And that's the big point that Galatians makes with that. But we probably should move on here. I just get really excited about all the Jesus prophecy in this one. But moving on, number four. So that was number three. We had the covenant with Adam is number one. The covenant with Noah is number two. Number three is the covenant with Abraham. And number four is probably the one that we've heard the most about, the Mosaic Covenant, or as it's probably more appropriately called, the Old Covenant. And the Old Covenant's number four. This is established in Exodus 24. This is between God and the children of Israel. It's a blood contract between God and the physical descendants of Jacob. Jacob also being named Israel, same person. And essentially, if I had to sum it up, and this is kind of how I wrote it this morning, it's blessings in exchange for obedience. That's pretty much the Old Covenant. Here is the law. It, of course, includes the law. Here's what you have to do. Here's what, how, you know, you have to keep this. And if you do this perfectly, well, then, you know, then here's some blessings that'll come upon you. Also, incidentally, if you do not keep this, here is a laundry list of curses that will befall upon you. And what we know from reading through the Old Testament is that, you know, when they first get into Canaan, there's moments where it looks like everything's going to be okay and they're going to keep this covenant and these blessings that were promised are going to come upon them. But it quickly goes awry and you never really see those blessings. You never see the Old Covenant really this is how it was supposed to look or anything. The closest thing you have is the reign of Solomon, but the reign of Solomon was cut short because of his sin, you know, because of his idolatry. And then all of that fell apart. The kingdom was divided. So you never actually really see this. Again, this all comes down to Jesus, which is the only time you ever see the law kept and the only time you ever see the Old Covenant fulfilled is in Jesus Christ. So Jesus is the fulfillment of the Old Covenant. He's the fulfillment of the Abrahamic Covenant. It's all about him. He's wrote about, actually, Moses writes about Jesus. God tells Moses this, at least. He says that I'm going to raise up a prophet like you from among the Israelites, and I'm going to put my words in his mouth. Right out of the chutes, actually, I think it's Exodus 19. Don't necessarily quote me on that address. I think it's Exodus 19, when you have God speak the Ten Commandments to the Israelites from on top of Mount Sinai. They hear the voice of God. They see the fire. They see the smoke. So there's no doubt, I would hope, in anyone's mind that Yahweh is indeed on this mountain, but they are so terrified of him. They're so scared that they beg that he doesn't speak to them anymore. They say, please, no more. You're like, Moses, you go ahead, you go up there, but we don't want to hear another word out of God, essentially. And that's when God gives this promise that, okay, you know, he says, what they say is good. I will raise up from them a prophet like you, and I will put my words in his mouth, meaning I will speak through him. That's actually talking about Jesus Christ. And that is exactly what Jesus says when he lectures the Pharisees, and he says, if you believe Moses, you would believe me because Moses wrote about me. You know, I'm the person, I'm the prophet that was raised up, that God is now speaking through, and you guys don't believe me, just like you don't believe him. So at any rate, that's number four, is the Old Covenant, the Mosaic Covenant. Either one of those would be correct, or the law. You could just call it the law, because the law, that's what it means. You know, it's the law, it would embody Old Covenant, Mosaic Covenant. Going down here a little bit, number five is the covenant with David, or the Davidic covenant, if you want the religious term, the Davidic covenant. That one I actually don't mind using because it's easier to say. The Noahic or whatever, I struggle with that one. I'm like, I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly, but Davidic, I think I'm pronouncing it correctly. So the Davidic covenant is between God and David. And this one is stated, I think, a couple different times, but if I had to summarize it, I would just say it's that David will have a descendant reigning on the throne. You know, he'll have a descendant that reigns. And of course, this is fulfilled by Jesus Christ as well, who is from the line of David, and he has an eternal kingdom. So he's the last Davidic king, but he's eternal. So David will always does have a descendant on the throne. He does until this day, and he always will in the person of Jesus Christ. Anyway, and that kind of segues us into the New Testament, which there's only one covenant in the New Testament, and that's the New Covenant. And the New Covenant is kind of the culmination of everything that's been leading up to this, because everything's been about Jesus Christ. And him coming and his blood and his finished work becomes the New Covenant, this covenant that was promised, through the prophets. You have Ezekiel speak of this. Jeremiah actually coins the term New Covenant. I believe it's Jeremiah 31. He actually says, the days are coming when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. We're going to talk about that here in a little bit when we talk about New Covenant, New Testament, kind of the differences there. But when Jesus Christ comes, he ushers in the new covenant. The new covenant fulfills all the preceding covenants, all the ones that had come before it, and really sets them aside, because now the new covenant is kind of what, again, all these had led up to, but they're not really, they lead up to it, but they don't go with it, if that makes sense. You know, that you know, the Abrahamic covenant speaking of this in little bits, the law is speaking of this in little bits, you know, all these things, but they don't also go along with it, if that makes sense. The new covenant is as a new and separate thing. It's new wine. So, you know, and that's just kind of the rundown on those. That's just kind of the rundown on the covenants that we have in Scripture, not taking into consideration, like I said, covenant theology, which would add a bunch more and confuse the heck out of all of us. But really, you know, it's good to have a knowledge of the Old Testament covenants, but really, guys, I mean, just knowing Jesus Christ, you know the fulfillment of the Old Testament covenants. So I don't know. I mean, if this is something that interests you and you really want to dive into these, you know, that's great. But really, you know, you have the reality. You have the new covenant. You have the reality to which all these old ones pointed to. So, you know, like I said, if it interests you, it is fascinating. I love studying them. But again, you have the wisdom. You have the knowledge. You have the authentic in the new covenant. You have the real thing. So, all right. And that kind of segues us into the next part of this. I mean, the next part of the question, new covenant, new testament. Are there any differences between these two? Are they the same thing? Well, it depends on who you ask. You know, the King James Version is where a lot of this confusion comes from. And what the King James Version has done is in a lot of the places where, like, so I don't know what versions everybody uses, but pretty much all of the more modern ones say New Covenant throughout the texts. It'll say New Covenant. The King James says New Testament in a lot of these places, New Testament. Now, that's technically not incorrect. Because the word covenant, contract, will, and testament are all one word in Greek, which is diatheke. It means the same exact thing. So we really could, and perhaps we should, but we really could with our Bibles, how we have it divided where it says Old Testament and New Testament, we really could put Old Covenant, Old Contract, Old Will. We really could do that because those terms are actually all interchangeable. They mean the exact same thing. So like I said, we might want to do that. We should do Old Covenant, New Covenant. I think that would help people understand a lot better. We would want to begin the New Covenant in the proper place, though, in the New Testament. We'd want to begin it at the cross. So we'd want to include most of the Gospels, actually, in the Old Testament, in the Old Covenant. That would be appropriate. And actually have the New Covenant begin at the cross. And then from that point on, just so there wasn't any confusion with that. But so let's just talk about the King James using Testament a little bit. You know, it uses Testament quite a bit. So why is that a problem? I guess it's not. It's fine. Again, it's the same word. Here's where it becomes a problem, though. There is this little thing out there. And I say that sarcastically, kind of, but not in a mean-spirited way. Maybe sarcastic's the wrong word. But there's this belief set out there called dispensationalism. And one of the many, 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 many things the dispensationalists believe, and there's no agreement on any of this. They do nothing but infight. There's different dispensations, all these things. Sometimes there's seven, sometimes there's 12. It's very hard to keep track of. But at any rate, part of this is that the new covenant is exclusive between the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It is not with us. It's not with us Gentiles in the flesh. It is exclusive between Israel and Judah. And they use the King James Version primarily. That's primarily the text that dispensationalists will use, and the King James Version will support this because the King James Version does not use testament. Does not use covenant to describe what Jesus accomplished at the cross. So, for an example, Luke, and I don't know the chapter or verse, but I know that Luke is the gospel that actually says New Covenant when Jesus is at the Last Supper. He says, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sins." But in the King James Version, he says, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood." In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, where we're familiar with the phrase competent ministers of the new covenant, the KJV says competent. Well, I'm not actually sure if it says competent ministers, but it says something like that in probably Elizabethan English. It says competent ministers of the Old Testament. So I was first kind of made aware of this when, I think it was back in February, I made a couple of videos, actually. They're on YouTube, and I kind of break down all the different things about the New Covenant and the New Testament in these videos. But essentially, I had somebody leave a really kind of harsh comment. It was just, you know, capital letters, and that you could tell this guy was really angry with what I had done. And he was going on and on about how he's like, this is, you know, because I was saying that we're under the New Covenant, like us as Christians, we're in the New Covenant. And he's going on. Hebrews has clearly a dispensational epistle to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. And then he put in like kind of bigger letters, like Paul never used the phrase new covenant, not even one time. And you know, I read that and I was like, well, he did, though. He used it actually several times. But then when I started studying it, I kind of looking this up, I was like, oh, it's a KJV thing. He doesn't use it in the KJV. And they imagine there's a difference between Testament and Covenant. So regardless of where we're at with any of that, diatheke, covenant, contract, will, testament are the exact same words. So even though the KJV, for some strange reason, renders this as testament, it's not really wrong. It's not wrong. It is the New Testament. It is the New Covenant. These are the exact same thing. Now, that being said, the New Testament, I suppose, could mean two different things, though, couldn't it? It could mean the covenant that Jesus accomplished with his blood. It also could mean the section in our Bibles. So in that sense, when, you know, being asked, what are there differences between the New Covenant and the New Testament? No, if we're talking about the finished work of Christ. Yes, if we're talking about the sections in the Bible, because that's very important. You know, when we go to the sections in the Bible, you know, the New Testament would actually begin. It begins like, you know, Matthew 1:1 is the beginning of the New Testament. But Hebrews has a very interesting verse that explains a little bit of this. And this is kind of how I base my whole understanding of how the testaments, you know, where does the New Testament, the New Covenant, where does this really begin? In placing this at the cross and not at the manger. And that's because for a covenant to be ratified, there has to be the death of the one who made it. And Hebrews says this. I'm going to read this a little bit. NIV puts this beautifully. So I'm going to read it in the NIV translation. This is what it says. This is Hebrews 9, 16 through 17. It says, in the case of a will, it is necessary to prove the death of the one who made it. Now remember, a diatheke can mean will too. So you could say in the case of a covenant, it is necessary to prove the death of the one who made it. In the case of a testament. We still use that. You know, last living will and testament. We still say that to this day. We don't really say covenant. Covenant's kind of an old word, but we say will and testament. So in the case of a will, it is necessary to prove the death of the one who made it, because a will is in force only when somebody has died. It never takes effect while the one who made it is still living. Meaning that as long as Jesus is alive, the new covenant is not in effect. A death is mandated for that. And he kind of, the author of Hebrews goes on to compare this with the old covenant. He's saying, and that is why even the old covenant had to come by blood. And he parodies what happened with Jesus to this establishment rather of the old covenant. He parodies these up. So Jesus, you know, the one who made it had to die. It had to be at his death in order for this covenant, for this will, essentially, to take effect. You know, if we just compare that to any human will, we all, I think everyone understands that a human will is only in effect when somebody has died. So if I make a, you know, last living will and testament, and I don't have any children, but let's say I'm not a good example. Let's, because I don't have anybody to leave anything to. Take somebody else that, take somebody that's a father that has, you know, has children, okay? And he makes a last living will and testament, and he kind of divides up all his assets among his children. And, you know, upon his death, now all of these things are going to be given out to his children. The children can't cash in on that before the father dies. And, you know, in the case of a will, it is necessary to prove the death of the one who made it. They can't just go around claiming all that stuff. And that's how the New Covenant was as well. And it's necessary to prove the death. So that, and you can kind of team that up a little bit with what we have in Galatians 4. I'm going to quote this from memory, so bear with me. But at the proper time, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law. You know, born under the law. Jesus is born under the law. Team that up with what you have in Luke, the Gospel of Luke, the opening where Mary and Joseph, they have Jesus, and they go to do the purification rites at the temple. You know, Mary goes through that, and they circumcise Jesus on the eighth day, incidentally. So they're keeping the law. I mean, they're keeping the law. They're offering birds. I think they've offered pigeons, I believe it was, or perhaps doves. Not entirely sure on the type of bird that was offered there, but the whole... the reason that's important, and to bring up that they offered birds and not an animal, I believe, is because of the fact that they were too poor to offer the animal. They offered birds because that was the law. If you were too poor, birds were also acceptable, and that's what Mary and Joseph offered there. So regardless, I mean, you have a lot of scripture that places Jesus under the law, that places him being born under the law. And then you have a lot of scripture that says the new covenant would not have begun until his death, and really ratified it at the resurrection. You know, it began at his death, but really, really ratified because we're actually saved by his life is what scripture says. You know, the cross forgives us of all sins. That's the propitiation for the entire world. But in order for us to really become the new creation in Christ, we have to die with Christ. So there's the cross. We have to be buried and then raised again with him. You know, we have to be raised back to a new life, new heart, new spirit, everything that goes along with that. So, all right. And then just kind of to close this up, and then I'll go to the comments because I see a lot of them coming in there. Just kind of close this up, the everlasting covenant. You know, that was part of the question here is what are my thoughts on the everlasting covenant? And essentially, it depends on what the everlasting covenant, I guess, actually is. You know, I think that it is mentioned. It's a scriptural term, but as far as being defined, I think that there's, you know, I think Isaiah gives us a little bit, and I think that it's logical to come to a conclusion on what this would be, but scripture doesn't necessarily say this is the everlasting covenant or something like that. And Noah, the covenant with Noah, the Noahic, I hope I'm saying that right, the Noahic covenant is actually also described as being everlasting too. And of course it is, you know, this the covenant of the rainbow. So that one is described as being everlasting, but I think you have something else in there that might be described as the everlasting covenant as well. So let me look this, let me find this part in my notes here. Okay, so essentially, with the covenant with Noah, okay, God talks about that this is going to be everlasting. We talked a little earlier about how the covenant with Noah, you actually have a reissuance of what was spoken to Adam, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. You know, that covenant, you have a reissuance of that. So it's my belief, and I'm just sharing my opinion on this with you guys, because again, like I said, I'd love to hear your thoughts on it. But like I said, scripture does not necessarily tell us verbatim what the everlasting covenant is. It's my belief that it would be this this spoken covenant to Adam. It's my belief of that just because of what we see in Isaiah. And I'm going to read the Isaiah scripture to you guys a little bit, and I'll let you know how I kind of arrived at this conclusion. But in Isaiah, there's chapter 24, there's a rebuke in there against pretty much everyone. I mean, pretty much all peoples on the earth. And it's not spoken specifically to the Israelites, you know, and I really checked into that because I was like, if this is Old Testament scripture that's describing the Israelites or, you know, whether it's Israel or Judah or whatever this is, then we can't just take that and say that this is somehow about us. You know, we can't do that. But I think this is actually to just general. I think this is just to general peoples of the earth. So let me read it to you, and then I'd love to hear your thoughts on it. This is what it says. I think this is New American Standard. The earth will be completely laid waste and completely plundered, for the Lord has spoken this word. The earth dries up and crumbles away. The mainland dries out and crumbles away. The exalted people of the earth dwindle. And this is kind of where he's going to mention this. The earth is also defiled by its inhabitants, for they violated laws, altered statues, and broke the everlasting covenant. Therefore, a curse devours the earth, and those who live on it suffer for their guilt. Therefore, the inhabitants of the earth decrease in number, and very few people are left. So a charge that's being brought against, again, it doesn't really seem to be specific to Israel. It seems to be everybody, is that they have violated this everlasting covenant. The only scripture that I really, like I said, I can really find where you have, you know, God kind of issue, if you will, an everlasting covenant really comes from Genesis 9:16, when God says, when the rainbow is in the clouds, I will look at it to remember the everlasting covenant between God and all flesh that is on the earth. And really speaking of the Noahic covenant, the rainbow, that he's never going to flood the earth again, but kind of also keeping in mind that God had just got done restating the Adamic covenant to Noah, you know, that be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth, rule over it, subdue it. That covenant. So it's my thoughts, and like I said, it's my thoughts, my opinion, because that's just where I'm at with this, that is what God is speaking of in Isaiah 24, this everlasting covenant, people violating it. That's my thoughts on that. I guess, like, and then the final question I'd have is, okay, so are we bound by this then? You know, do we have to be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth? You know, if that's an everlasting covenant with all people, you know, regardless of, would we somehow be under this? Well, I mean, some people are born, you know, where they can't have children. You know, that's the first thought that jumps into my mind. So I'm like, well, can't really be like they're mandated to, you know, multiply or anything like that. I don't know. I'd have to give that a lot of thought. It's a tough subject, and I know it gets abused. I had this book a while back that it's on covenant theology and, you know, all the things that go with that. And one of them was the everlasting covenant and how there's the everlasting covenant. And this was not scriptural, but because there's the everlasting covenant, all the covenants kind of are melded into this one and all kinds of abuse with that. So those are just my thoughts on it. I think that is what scripture is referring to when he talks about the everlasting covenant. I think it's actually talking about this Adamic covenant. So, but let me jump to the comments here. And I'd love to hear your thoughts on that. So, all right. Amber says no. Good morning, Amber. I think when you said that, Amber, I was talking about the difference between the old. Is there a difference between the old covenant and the new covenant? I think that's when you said no. And there isn't. Not officially. I mean, they're the exact same word. Good morning, Larry. Larry says exactly right, the same word. Yeah, diatheke, it's the exact same word. So officially, whether or not that, you know, the KJV uses testament or covenant, it's really irrelevant. It's the exact same. It means the exact same thing. Amber says, I think it's how and where we use the words that confuses people, sections. Yeah, probably speaking of the Old and the New Testament, you know, because the divide isn't necessarily correct because it's not at the cross, it's at the manger. Larry says, I love the KJV because it says the death of the tester. Tested, am I saying that right, Larry? And clearly it invokes a last will and testament. Okay. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. That's beautifully put. Why does it say bishops and deacons in Philippians 1:1? Were titles later translated to this? Are you talking about the KJV? It says that perhaps? I don't know off the top of my head. I'd have to research that and see, like, you know, what are the Greek words that are used there, and what really is the proper one? You know, what really is the proper term to be using there? Okay, Larry's that verse and surrounding verses is what helped me understand why Jesus taught law when he was alive. Yes, amen. Yeah, so he's under, you know, everyone there is under the law. I mean, the cross hasn't happened yet. I can safely say my wife and I have a 36-year covenant. Good morning, Manuel. Yes, the covenant of marriage. Yes, there sure are a lot of us. Awesome. Okay. Oh, presbyters and Larry says presbyters and okay. I thought there were no positions or authority. Larry, you may have a better answer for that than I do. I have not dived like really deep into that necessarily. I just did a couple of live streams on like pastor and those kind of things, but I didn't really get into the difference, like, you know, elders, deacons, those kind of things. I didn't really dive into that. So I can come back to that, like I said, unless you know, somebody else has a better answer to that question than I do, because I don't want to just give you an opinion without studying it. So I'd want to actually go to the Greek words and everything and really get that right before sharing that with you guys. So all right, guys, well, thanks so much for tuning in. I really appreciate the conversation. David, we'll go back to that, the presbyters and diakons. I hope I'm probably slaughtering the Greek when I'm saying that, but we'll go back to that. You know, we can definitely talk about that here in the future. I don't know if I could get all that studying done by tomorrow, but if I can, we can talk about it tomorrow. So I'd love to see that. Love to dive into that with you guys. So thanks so much. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for listening. I really enjoy just fellowshipping with you guys like this. It just makes my mornings. Just absolutely love it. So love getting together and talking about Jesus. So thank you for the question. Thanks for sending me that the question, New Testament, New Covenant. Fascinating. Absolutely fascinating. Really enjoyed it. So see you guys later. I'll talk to you tomorrow. Bye.